What Saru is doing right now is trying her best, and her organization trying its best, to represent workers who have been incredibly hard hit by the current economic meltdown. I think in the city that I am in right now, in Burlington, Vermont, and cities all over this country, restaurants are closing, bars are closing, convention centers are closing, and those people who work in that industry are being laid off by the tens of thousands. So, Saru, thank you so much for being with us. And maybe if you could, let's begin by describing the current economic reality for the industry.
So I really think it's important to understand the reality that existed before coronavirus, because there were very deep structural inequities that existed in our industry prior. And I just wanted to clarify also, I founded the Restaurant Opportunity Center, but I lead a national coalition now that includes the Restaurant Opportunity Center called One Fair Wage, that has been fighting to eliminate the sub-minimum wage for tipped workers in the United States. That is still $2.13 an hour, which is a ludicrous shame for the United States of America. And especially it's a shame for the nation's largest and fastest growing industry, which is the restaurant industry. We hit almost the 14 million mark before the coronavirus, but we were the absolute lowest bottom of the barrel employer because of the power of a trade lobby called the National Restaurant Association. So here you are, you've got millions of workers paid $2 an hour or three or four, depending on their state.
Let me interrupt you if I could, so that everybody understands. I mean, what you're saying sounds so preposterous, maybe hard for people to believe you. But as all of you know, right now we have a horrifically low federal minimum wage of 7 1/4. That is terrible. For waiters and waitresses and people in the tip economy, it is much lower than that. And that's what Saru is talking about. Unbelievable. It really is quite unbelievable.
It's a literal legacy of slavery, because the first tipped workers were hired after emancipation by the Restaurant Association, which demanded the right to hire them for nothing and let them live on tips because they were black. We went from zero in emancipation to $2.13 an hour today. And it is now 70% women working as waitresses and IHOPs and Denny's and small mom and pop restaurants across America. These are the women who've been largely laid off as a result of this crisis. And if you can imagine how horrible it is to think about unemployment insurance on the minimum wage, I want you to just think about unemployment insurance on a $2 wage plus tips. How ridiculous and crazy that is, especially when tips are a rough calculation. Neither the workers nor the employers nor the government has a clear understanding of how much these workers make in tips. There are a lot of cash tips. And so an unemployment insurance as a measure of a $2 wage plus tips is a non-starter. It's nothing. And when you couple that with the fact that the vast majority of these workers don't even qualify for unemployment insurance, not just because of their status, we have a lot of documented immigrants who are refusing to apply for unemployment insurance because they know it will hurt their applications for permanent residency or for citizenship, because the government is going to see them as a burden on the state. But even beyond that, there are millions of workers who are not eligible because they don't work enough hours or they haven't worked long enough in the restaurant. And so our numbers show the majority of these workers won't get unemployment insurance.
I'm going to interrupt you then again, because sometimes people say, what she's saying really can't be true. Sounds a little bit crazy.
Right.
I heard recently, I should have known this, somebody told me that 3/4 of American workers are not eligible for unemployment compensation. And this is a result, year after year, Republican attacks on the entire social welfare network. But your point is well taken. You have workers out there who cannot get unemployment.
That's right, the majority. That's the majority.
The checks will be minuscule.
That's right.
I didn't interrupt you, but I wanted to...
No, it's critical to understand that while you've got the Republicans putting forward massive bailouts, that you're talking about unemployment insurance that will not impact most workers in our industry, and for those that get it, it's measured on a $2 or $3 wage. And even if they're talking about cash payments, cash relief to these workers, so many workers are not going to be able to access that due to status, or again, because they're documented but don't want to accept payment because it will not be favorable when they apply for citizenship. So we've got a very, very broken system. And I think the hope that I am seeing is that a lot of workers are waking up, a lot of employers even are waking up, because so many had to lay off so many people and realize that so many of their employees were living tip to mouth. And I really, I've been saying that phrase a lot in the last couple of days, tip to mouth. Friday, March 13th, thousands of restaurants and bars shut down across America. People got tips on that day. Maybe they used those tips to feed their families on Saturday and Sunday. Come Monday, they have literally nothing to feed their kids.
So do we have any ideas, you know, all across this country, restaurants and bars are being shut down. Do we have any idea of how many workers have been laid off?
Our estimate is about 4 million that have either been laid off or are at immediate risk of being laid off right now. But the industry, as I mentioned, is over 13 million, getting closer to 14 million. I think we're going to see at least another 8 to 9 million workers laid off in the next couple of weeks. You are talking about a disaster along the lines I don't think we've seen since the Great Depression.
All right. So your workers are low paid. Many of them are very low paid. And now they're going to lose their job. Many of them, I imagine, have very little in the bank.
That's right.
Limited resources. What happens to these? Most of them women.
Yes. Vast majority. 70% are women. 40% are single mothers. They can barely afford the rent. I can't tell you the number of workers who, before coronavirus, told us stories like, I feed my kids with my tips. Me, myself, I go eat during what they call family meal at the restaurant. That's my meal for the day, is when the restaurant feeds us before work. Or I work three jobs and we live out of my car because I can't afford the rent. This was before coronavirus. Now that income is gone. And so on top of having nothing to feed themselves, they have nothing to feed their children. That is a disaster of the highest proportions.
I couldn't agree with you more, and I worry every single day. There are people in the restaurant industry and other industries that right now, saying, I don't have any money to feed the kids.
That's right.
All right, tell me what you would like. First of all, congratulations for what you're doing. And what you are exposing is, forget the coronavirus for a moment, and what that is doing to the economy and to the health concerns. And I would imagine that your waitresses and waiters and people in your industry are in contact with a whole lot of people.
Oh, yes. Yes.
I'm sure they're helping all kinds of stuff, yes?
Yes, absolutely.
Food, okay.
Yes.
So they're concerned about health issues as well. But I think the first point to be made is that even under normal times, it is outrageous about how many people are struggling economically in that industry. That should not be happening in the United States of America. If you work 40 hours a week, you should be earning a living wage. Many of your people are not. And now we got the crisis of the layoffs and the coronavirus. Okay. What would you like to see Congress do?
Congress, first of all, needs to change unemployment policy. It needs to apply to everybody, and it needs to be applied based on a $15 minimum wage plus tips. You know, if this moment has not exposed why a $2 wage is ridiculous, shameful, a literal legacy of slavery, I don't know what moment could make it clearer. And so rather than measuring these workers' unemployment insurance based on $2 plus tips, it needs to be measured based on $15 plus tips, and it needs to be applied across the board. We need to see this as a public health disaster, because what happens when everybody can't access unemployment insurance? I'll tell you what happens. First thing that happens, people leave their homes. They start moving in together. They start having communal kitchens, because what else can they do? They start lining up at soup kitchens or other places to get food, because what else can they do? And what does that do to our public health disaster? And so unless we reevaluate how we're giving out unemployment insurance, unless we think about social safety nets that actually apply to everybody, this is a disaster that will finally show America that even the 1% are not immune when the 99% is suffering. They're not immune because the public health disaster is brought to their door. And so what we need is to everybody to go to ofwemergencyfund.org. We are supporting not just restaurant, but other service and tipped workers, Uber, Lyft, Instacart, DoorDash drivers, nail salon, car wash, all kinds of tipped workers are applying to this fund. We are about to hit the 100,000 worker mark. About 3 workers are applying every minute. We need you to donate to the fund so that we can actually get these workers cash, at least for groceries for the month. And then there's also a volunteer button, and you've got Senator Sanders, an amazing base of people who could help us, because we are calling every single one of those 100,000 workers. We are organizing them, screening them for their need, and registering them to vote. Because a lot of the workers are saying, I cannot believe I'm in this situation after decades of work. I have nothing to feed my kids. I'm ready to organize. And we need an army of volunteers to help us call people, get them into the system, register them to vote. And so you can click the volunteer button. We'll send you a list of volunteers. We'll train you how to make the calls. We'll send you a script. It's really easy. So we need you to spread the word, donate, and volunteer. That's what we can do together. And then we need to push on the government to change these social safety nets. We need to fight for one fair wage, a full minimum wage with tips on top once and for all.
So we'll give you a website again, please.
It's www.OFW, O like O, one fair wage, OFW, emergencyfund.org.
Are you hearing concerns about the health aspects of the coronavirus?
Absolutely. Everybody's terrified. I mean, everybody's terrified. I just think there's a, all of us are terrified. I think when you think about a single mother who has to take care of her kids, there's a kind of an order of survival, right? Feed my children, stay in my home if I have a home, and then worry about the fact that we're going to get infected. I mean, all three things relate to survival. And it's just not the situation that the United States of America should be. And I want to reiterate, this is not a tiny industry that's getting $2 an hour or that has gotten. This is the largest and fastest growing industry in America. This is the largest employer of women allowed to pay $2 an hour. If nothing has exposed why greed does not work in our country, this has to.
I think what Saru is talking about is, and it's unfortunate that it takes the kind of crisis we are experiencing right now to bring it to the fore. But there have been millions and millions of people, not unemployed, but working and working hard, who don't have the income to take care of their kids, to have a decent home for their kids. And this is the economy before coronavirus, and those people are now on the line and are facing very frightening times. I can only imagine how frightened the people in the industry are right now. And all I can say is I agree with you that we have got to make sure that every American gets unemployment, and that that unemployment is based on a living wage, not $2 an hour, which is not going to do you much good. Anything else you want to share with us, Ruth?
I do. I want to point out that there are 800 restaurants that have been working with us for the last several years who actually believe in a livable wage for their workers, no subminimum wage for tipped workers. They're all over the country. And you can actually support those restaurants with food delivery or just gift certificates. You can find them on the ROC National Diners Guide, which is a free app in your app store. But I also want to say another thing the government can do, rather than mass bailouts or maybe in addition to bailouts, is look at special relief, incentives, rent relief, tax relief for employers who actually commit to one fair wage, commit to a full livable wage after the crisis. Right. That's the kind of policy that will help us after the crisis move away from a system that never worked in the first place.
We must demand, if corporations are going to get help from the government, they must be decent corporate citizens.
That's right.
Keeping their work, treating their workers with respect, their environment with respect, and so forth. I just want, first of all, thank you very much for what you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you for talking to a whole lot of people and explaining to them what is going on in your industry and the suffering that so many of the workers there are now experiencing and have experienced. Let's go forward together, and I would urge everybody to go to the website. Say it one more time.
Thank you. OFWemergencyfund.org.
All right, let's give a support to the restaurant workers as best we can. Saru, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.